all the educational programming just that you started in 2011, getting out in 2010. Mm-hmm. But I was able to go back in 2012 to Learnberg to speak at their graduation. And they were telling me how now they have a dedicated board for education, mm-hmm. And how the programs that you've implemented, I believe, at the beginning have changed. And I just wanted to say thank you.
I'd like to make a comment. To the educational component, it's a game changer. And I recommend all the time for people who come out of incarceration or not to pursue that. And so I wasn't involved with the changes that you made as well because I was last released in 2008. However, I'm very hopeful today because years ago we didn't have what we have here today. And so I think it's important to recognize this, the progress that's been made. In 2008, I couldn't find help, support, and things that we have today. Maybe five people or whatever, I don't know. But even though we're not where we need to get, we have made significant progress, and we've done that together.
Mm-hmm. But let me tell you, not everybody supports what we're doing. Obviously, that officer doesn't. there are some legislators that don't.
Yeah.
3 years ago, 4 years ago, I was downtown at the General Assembly lobbying for resources. And a member of the House Appropriations Committee told me that you are number two in the nation. That's where we're number two, with the lowest rates of recidivism. He said, you're number two in the nation right now. He said, you don't need to be any lower. He said, as far as I'm concerned, you could have been number 25, right in the middle, and I'll be happy. So that's the thinking. Luckily, we were able to get resources and so forth, and since that conversation, for the next 3 years, we have been number one in the nation. But even in the legislature, there are people that are willing to acquiesce that do not believe that we ought to be engaged to the degree that we're engaged. So. Yes, ma'am?
Just really quick.
Did I answer your question?
Yes and no.
Oh. Yes and no.
Well,
or maybe
so. The reason why I say no is because I travel the world, and I'm familiar with a lot of their way that they, set consequences, and it's different than here. Vastly different. And I guess that's when I saw those numbers. That was very alarming to me because I was not expecting it to be that high for many reasons. One, because in my mind, I see United States being a role model for other countries. And that's not being a really good role model.
No, as a matter of fact, let me tell you, I have been to international conferences.
Right.
I was in Australia recently. I have been to Bangkok. Mm-hmm. I have been to the Czech Republic for these international correctional conferences. Mm-hmm. And every place we go, we stand out as the barbarians.
Yeah.
As a matter of fact, I was on a panel in Bangkok, and a big guy, I'll never forget that experience, he was about 6'4", a Brit, English guy. He got up, he was in the audience, and he said, referring to me, he says, there is nothing that the Yanks can teach us in the area of justice, wow, given their record.
Wow. Mm.
Right.
And I went, but I'm trying to change. This guy was imposing. I didn't want to get into a fight.
I did want to make a comment on the slide that you had shown for mental health percentages of men and women.
Yes.
Unfortunately, a lot of the studies that are done in the mental health field about percentages of mental health between the genders, that's very skewed. It's men are not represented well, and for many reasons. I think men are up there with the women. They just don't report it.
Yeah,
for many reasons, like culture or just their role in the family, or, you know, the list goes on and on.
Yeah, but interestingly enough, I've mentioned working in 41 states, mm-hmm. and in every state, in the Department of Corrections, the numbers are similar. They're very similar, almost the same division between men and women. And some states, because of men, you know, they buck up and they don't report. The women are more likely to seek help and assistance. And that's probably going to be a big part of it. Because we certainly, you guys and guys, that you some men don't know. That I'm not reported. But that's probably part of it. But interestingly enough, in those four Department of Corrections that I'm familiar with, that I've worked in, the numbers are very similar. So you're reporting for their reason is along the same lines. Yes, ma'am.
You continue to mention about getting closer to the other, I'll say that, in as a means to bridge, I guess, the actions of law enforcement and those who are actually arrested. And I like the way that you guys use the word, what was it, returning citizen, as opposed to like ex-con and whatnot. But question for you is, in your position as Director of Corrections, do you really think that you'll be able to see a change within your time as a director with that minimal getting closer? Because as I see, I was reading a book called The New Jim Crow about mass incarceration and how, you know, pretty much the jail and the prison system is still going to keep black individuals as a secondary or sub-person within America. Mm-hmm. Also, it started with the actual idea of policing was to police the Negro or to police the slave. Do you think that in this time, let's say within the next, I don't know how long you're to
look. Well, first of all, Marcus Hodges gave me that book, The New Jim Crow, in 2010. That's when I read it. Marcus gave me that book.
So it's been 9 years. Have you seen what's changed?
Yeah, and yes, I have seen changes. I got to tell you that I have seen changes throughout my career that I did not believe that I would see. I have seen changes in the Nebraska and concerning Virginia, D.C. that I did not think that I was going to experience. I did what I thought we used to do, about with programs and so forth, and I thought that over time everything would take hold and keep on moving it and keep on pushing it. But guess what? It went boom. And the system has changed. We do surveys every year of everybody, and they can respond anonymously. We began the first set of surveys with the Urban Institute. You familiar with that?
Yes.
So the Urban Institute came in and did the first set of surveys. And they were shocked that by the second survey, year two, the shift that they had seen in the culture of the department. And as we all know, the culture is what determines the degree to which we are going to be able to achieve objectives and be successful. The Urban Institute saw that then. Back then, right about 12% of our staff said that we should lock them up and throw the key away.
Lock them up like black
men? The inmates.
Oh.
Lock them up and throw the key away.
Oh,
12% of our staff were saying so. That number has dropped gradually. And what was the number in this last survey? 6.1%. 6.1% in that short period of time. That's a culture shift. And so yes, we can get to people, educate people, talk to people, get to know them, let them get to know you, and don't allow easy passes. Hold them accountable for what they say and what they do. And then thinking will engage. So
we have
some changes.
One last question.
I had a question about the women in prison thing. I commend you for doing that. I did some research. People naturally assume there's a federal protocol for state prisons for women's health, and there's not. It's a states' rights issue, which states' rights is code for social control and racism, especially in the South. So I just wanted to say I really commend you. How can we find out more about your program when it finally gets on the ground running?
Well, actually, we get the, as you heard, Mr. Robinson said, the recommendations are due to me again. What?
May
1st. May 1st, we go through those and make some mistakes. That's one thing.
My research, just to let people know if you don't know, there's some states that don't even test women when they go into the system to see if they're pregnant. There's not a lot of health care. Women are I really commend you for taking this on, because I think women are very, their rights are very underrepresented.
And one last comment I just want to make. A gentleman mentioned earlier about the impact of the federal change in the law recently. What your question was?
No, I just asked you a question about the Criminal Justice Reform Act, right?
That the president signed.
Right.
Just for your information, that reform has nothing to do with the states. That only applies to the Federal Bureau of Prisons. The president has no authority over the states in terms of mandating what happens in the justice system. And so that only applies to the federal.